that make you go, things that make you.
That's going to be the subject of our next preaching series, things that make you go, Why don't we just practice that together? We got to get into the routine of going, Go ahead and practice, Even if that's not something typically done in your household, we're going to learn to do it here. And that's kind of like, I don't quite get it. It's kind of like, I'm not sure what that means. That's that expression. Are you guys ready for this? Well, I am. And we are going to have fun. What do you think of those chairs, huh? Aren't those awesome? And we want to thank the group that was here yesterday making them. We had a large group, and it was quite a job. We thought we'd have it easy, just screw them together, no problem. Well, it turned out to be a lot more than that. But we figured it out finally. And if you go to our Facebook page, you'll see a little live video there of Gordy and me and Alan building a chair. And we got it down to where we could build a chair every 90 seconds. Now, some of the women were doing a chair every 9 minutes. Oh, they're not happy with me about that. So we just were having fun. So anyway, we prayed over those chairs, by the way. And we're just believing that they're going to be places of salvations and places of being filled with the Holy Spirit, places with your neighbors to come and hear the gospel and your children to come and be raised in the ways of God. And we're just believing for the chairs to last until I'm dead. Because I never want to do it again. So here we go. All right. Are you guys ready? All right. So things that make you go, So odd things, weird things, things that are hard to unexplain. You're just like, what is that all about? Things that make you go, Every time I say that, you have to do it too. Things that make you go, There you go. There you go. Now, that expression isn't original with me. That expression was first kind of popularized by a guy named Arsenio Hall. I think we have a picture of Arsenio. Our guys are working on it. There's Arsenio. And he was big back in the 80s. I don't even know what he's doing anymore. But he was a big talk show host, and he came up with that. And he came up with these ideas of things that make you go, It's like Letterman had a top 10 list, And this guy had things that make you go, And so here's a few examples of things that make you go, All right? Number one, why do we park in driveways but drive on parkways? Yeah, how is it that as a building goes up, as it burns down? If the police arrest the mime, do they tell him he has the right to remain silent? What hair color do they put on the driver's license of bald men? So why do banks charge us an insufficient funds fee on money they know we don't have? Last one. If you're in a vehicle and you're going the speed of light, what happens when you turn on the headlights? The Bible's full of stories that make you go, it's things that are hard to understand in today's culture. Accounts, stories, portions of scripture that we read and we just kind of go, what in the world is that all about? And can that even matter? Well, you know what? Everything in God's word matters. Every account we read, even the ones that make us go, there's some purpose for being in God's word. So it's worth our while to study it, worth our while to kind of figure out what it's all about. And let's be honest, it's kind of fun to dig into those kind of difficult passages and see what they're all about. So today I want to start with a story about a man and his hair. Now, some of you guys have got hair. Some of us do not have much hair. But our hair is a big part of a man's life. In fact, I got some statistics about men and their hair that I thought was really, really interesting. Did you know, this is really wild, the longest recorded hair on a man belonged to a monk in a monastery in India. In 1949, his hair was 26 feet long. Holy mackerel. That's a big bun. 26 feet. Here's another one. The longest beard belongs to a man in Norway. His beard is 17 and a half feet long. That's kind of even gross, isn't it? To think of, what's he tucking in his pocket? I mean, what does he do with a 17 and a half foot beard? This is even, yeah. The longest beard of a bearded lady was Janice Devereaux of Kentucky, and the bearded lady's beard was 14 inches. The longest mustache belonged to a Brahmin, and his mustache was, get this, 102 inches. Wow. You wonder, how did he even eat? I mean, you'd have to part the ways, right, to get the... Here's one that I don't have to think much about anymore, but there are three ways a man can wear his hair. Man can wear his hair three ways. He can wear it parted, he can wear it unparted, or he can wear it departed. Man and his hair. So our spotlight this morning falls on Judges chapter 16. Judges chapter 16. So if you have your Bibles, why don't you follow along with me? We're going to put them on the screen, but there's still nothing like reading it in your own Bible. And we're going to talk about one of those passages that make you go, hmm. Judges 16, 16 through 22. Just give you a moment. That's in your Old Testament, back towards the beginning. All right, here we go. Judges chapter 16. Starting with verse 16. It says, it came to pass when she pestered him daily with her words and pressed him so that his soul was vexed to death. Now, the she here is a gal named Delilah. And the him here is a man named Samson, who was very, very proud of his hair. And we're going to find out more about that. We're going to break that down in a minute. But I think some of us can understand how our souls are vexed to death by a woman. Don't hurt me. Verse 17. That he told her all in his heart and said to her, no razor has ever come upon my head, for I've been a Nazarite to God from my mother's womb. If I'm shaven, then my strength will leave me and I shall become weak and be like any other man. When Delilah saw that he had told her all his heart, she sent and called for the lords of the Philistines, saying, come up at once, for he has told me all his heart. So the lords of the Philistines came up to her and brought the money in their hand. Then she lulled him to sleep on her knees and called for a man and had him shave off the seven locks of Samson's head. Then she began to torment him, and his strength left him. She said, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. So he awoke from his sleep and said, I will go out as before at other times and shake myself free. But he did not know that the Lord had departed from him. Then the Philistines took him and put out his eyes and brought him down to Gaza. They bound him with bronze fetters, and he became a grinder in the prison. However, the hair of his head began to grow again after it had been shaven. All right, so that's what we're going to be talking about today. Now, the thing here that makes you go, what a person might ask himself is, what is the deal with his hair? What is the thing? You cut off his hair and his strength goes away? Guys get haircut all the time. Their strength doesn't go away. What's the deal with that? Why was cutting his hair such a disaster? Why was that such a big deal? What's going on here? Well, to understand it, we're going to imagine that we're in a bit of a like a Netflix time warp kind of thing here. If you ever watched a Netflix movie, you know they'll often start with the climax and then they wind back and build back up to it. So we've just read the climax of the story. Now we're going to wind back and see what brought us to this situation. Okay? So what we want you to do is go to Judges chapter 13, go back three chapters, and we're going to make a quick survey of what got him to the place with Delilah and having his hair cut. You know, it's interesting when you look at Samson, it's almost like you're reading a story of like a superhero. Superheroes are big right now with the kids, and they all love to talk about superheroes. And Samson's life reads almost like a superhero. The guy was amazing in his strength and what he did. But this is a superhero story with a very tragic end. You know, a lot of writers throughout the years have written tragedies where things don't end well. And this reads a little bit like a superhero tragedy. So let's begin with his birth. That's in Judges chapter 13, 1 through 5. So follow along. We get a little history here. 13, 1 through 5. It says, again, the children of Israel did evil in the sight of the Lord, and the Lord delivered them into the hand of the Philistines for 40 years. Now there was a certain man from Zorath of the family of the Danites whose name was Manoah, and his wife was barren and had no children. And the angel of the Lord appeared to the woman and said to her, indeed, now you are barren and have borne no children, but you shall conceive and bear a son. Now, therefore, please be careful not to drink wine or similar drink and not to eat anything unclean. For behold, you shall conceive and bear a son, and no razor shall come upon his head, for the child shall be a Nazarite to God from the womb, and he shall begin to deliver Israel out of the hand of the Philistines. Now, in your Bibles, the key verse is verse 5. That's what's setting up the story ahead. When we're told that for this son that she is going to bear, and it's a supernatural birth, it's not a virgin birth, but it's a supernatural birth, and that she had never had a son. She had been considered barren. And so the Lord is going to give her favor, cause her to have a son. And you can see here that the child will be a Nazarite. We'll talk about that in a little bit. And no razor shall touch the hair on his head. And so you begin to get some sense of what was the big deal about the hair later on. Now, a little bit of understanding here. The nation of Israel was under the rule of the Philistines. The Philistines were seagoing people, lived along the coast. And the Philistines first arrived in Israel about 1200 B.C., before Christ. And they very quickly, basically, kind of took over the place. And they did that because they had two things the Israelites did not have. First of all, they had the ability to get in boats and go throughout the Mediterranean area doing commerce and sales and importing necessary things. Having boats that could sail across that Mediterranean Sea was a big deal. And the Philistines were seafaring people and had an economic edge. The second thing, and this maybe is the most important thing, and this becomes more important as you read on later with the Philistines and Israelites, the Philistines could make iron. They had metallurgy. Now, at this point in history, the Jews were basically using sharp rocks. Even their hoes and their harrows for making the farms were rocks that had been chiseled and made sharp. The Philistines had metallurgy. So they had sharp metal arrows. They had metal hoes and different kinds of things they could use. And so this gave them a military advantage because of that metallurgy. So the Philistines had more technology. And for that reason, they had gained a military advantage over the Israelites. Now, this lady is promised that her child would be a Nazarite. Now, you got to get this understanding. A Nazarite is not the same as a Nazarene. We think of Jesus of Nazareth, a Nazarene. That's not what this means. A Nazarene is a person from Nazareth. But a Nazarite was something else. A Nazarite was a person who was fully consecrated to the service of God. They were a person who had been set aside to serve God all their life. And thus they had to make certain vows and keep those vows to be consecrated. See, in the temple, they had certain elements that were consecrated for God's work only. They had lavers, they had spoons, they had forks, they had knives. They had different implements in the temple that were only for God's work. Can we all get that? These were consecrated things. You couldn't take a temple fork, then take it home and have French fries and eat it with that fork. It was only for God's things. Now, a Nazarite was a person who was only for God's things, consecrated for that. Now, the vow of a Nazarite doesn't mention as much here, but in other places it talks about it. The Nazarite vow included three things. Now, this is important because we're going to talk about three strikes and you're out. Okay? There were three things a Nazarite had to do. First of all, a Nazarite could not drink any kind of alcohol or intoxicating drinks. Now, some of you says, what is an alcohol an intoxicating drink? Well, there were other kinds of intoxicating drinks than alcohol. They were like drugs. They had teas. They had other kinds of things they'd mix up that were intoxicating. So they couldn't have alcohol or intoxicating drinks. Not even one. None. So that was the first thing. The second thing is they couldn't go near or touch a dead body. And that would include like a dead animal. And you can imagine in that culture, that was a bit of an issue to not get near a dead animal, where there would be a lot of those around. So no alcoholic or intoxicating drinks, no touching of a dead body or getting near a dead body. And the third one was they had to leave their hair long. Could never cut their hair. And again, that seems like kind of an odd thing, doesn't it? You think, what's the deal with that? Well, of course, that's an outward sign that they're a Nazarite. It would really stand out in the crowd that this person's a Nazarite. So Samson, even from birth, is consecrated to God and given those three things that he must never break. Those are his oath. And now, the key to his strength, now get this, was not in the keeping of the vows. His strength was in the God who could flow through a fully consecrated person. His strength wasn't in the keeping of the vows. His strength was in the Holy Spirit who could flow through him because he was fully consecrated to God. Everybody with me on that? We got to get that. Now, the thing about this is that if you were Samson, this was all set up before you were born. And now the question becomes this. Just how bought into all this was Samson? Maybe some of you guys can follow that train of thought. Maybe you have a sense that from the time before you were born, things were laid out for you. Well, that's kind of what was happening here with Samson. See, the Lord had told his family, this is what he will be. And maybe Samson's, he's thinking a little bit like, wait a minute, do I get a say in this? Because this is going to be a different and odd kind of life for him. So anyway, his life becomes a bit of a roller coaster of ups and downs and victories and just odd stories. You'll have to read these three chapters, 13 through 16. They're fascinating to read, very interesting. But his life becomes something of a roller coaster. And I've been thinking a lot about this because I'm not exactly sure how much Samson, the man, was bought into Samson, the consecrated judge of Israel. I think he enjoyed very much being strong. Amen to that? I mean, I think he loved the fact that he was big and tough and could do just about anything like a superhero. I think he loved that. But the part about no alcohol, about not cutting his hair, no intoxicating drinks, not being around any dead things at all, I think that got to be a drag. And I'm not sure he's 100% bought into that. And my evidence for that is what happens in the story. What happens in the story. So, now to get to the hair, we got to hurry up. Judges chapter 14. Judges chapter 14. Now, before we read this, let me remind you guys of the story that he was born with a mission. The mission was to begin to deliver Israel from the Philistines. Raise your hand if you get it. A man on a mission, born to begin, he didn't say he would, but he'd begin to deliver Israel from the Philistines. The Philistines in this story are the bad guys. Got a balcony? Philistines are the bad guys. Okay. 14:1-4. Now Samson went down to Timnah and saw a woman in Timnah of the daughter of the Philistines. Stop right there. A daughter of the Philistines. Now, was Samson a Philistine church? No, he was an Israelite. Why is he hanging out with Philistine woman? We have a little bit of a rebellion issue here, folks. Maybe you once upon a time hung out with a boyfriend or a girlfriend you weren't supposed to hang out with. Yes, somebody just said. So he's down there hanging out with somebody he shouldn't be hanging out with. All right. Now, verse 2, 14:2. So he went up and told his father and his mother, saying, I've seen a woman in Timnah of the daughters of the Philistines. Now, therefore, get her for me as a wife. Uh-oh. Do you see trouble brewing, church? All right, 14:3. Then his father and mother said to him, is there no woman among the daughters of your brethren, among all my people, that you must go and get a wife from those uncircumcised Philistines? And Samson said to his father, get her for me, for she pleases me well. But his father and mother did not know that this was of the Lord, that he was seeking an occasion to move against the Philistines. For at that time, the Philistines had dominion over Israel. All right. Samson, big, tough, strapping lad, tough as they come. And he gets in his head, he wants a Philistine wife. The uncircumcised Philistine. In fact, they make a point of pointing that out. That what are you doing? Mom and dad say, no way. Not one of our kids going to marry one of those kids. Not going to happen. Rebellion in the house. See, what you learn about Samson, and it's what plays out in our big scene a little later on, is this was a man, for all of his physical strength, was driven by lust and passion, and he had no or very little self-control. You know what? He was probably a mom and dad's favorite, don't you think? He was their only. I bet you he got everything he ever wanted. And he was used to getting everything he ever wanted. And so when he sees a Philistine woman, the people he's supposed to be destroying, and he says, I want that one, he's used to getting his way. Even though this was not the Lord's plan. Now, 5-7, let's watch how this unfolds. Track with me here, 5-7. So Samson went down to Timnah with his father and mother and came to the vineyards of Timnah. Now, to his surprise, a young lion came roaring against him. And the Spirit of the Lord came mightily upon him, and he tore the lion apart as one would have torn apart a young goat, though he had nothing in his hand. But he did not tell his father or mother what he had done. Then he went down and talked with the woman, and she pleased Samson well. After some time, when he returned to get her, he turned aside to see the carcass of the lion. And behold, a swarm of bees and honey were in the carcass of the lion. He took some of it in his hands and went along eating. When he came to his father and mother, he gave some to them, and they ate. But he did not tell them that he had taken it, he had taken the honey out of the carcass of the lion. Now, so they're heading down to this gal he's wanting to marry, Philistine woman. And out of nowhere, here comes this lion, attacks him. You think maybe you should get a clue that maybe God doesn't want you going down there? But he's so big and so strong, he takes out the lion. That's pretty crazy strong that he did that. So he takes out this lion, goes down there, and boy, he really wants this gal to be his wife. He really likes her. And the way home, he comes across the carcass, been laying out in the sun. It's rotting. Bees have made their home in it. And he helps himself to some of the honey. Now, church, all right. Is he allowed to touch a dead lion? No, he's not. That's absolutely right. One of the very things he'd vowed not to do was touch a dead thing. So now he's down in Philistia, making arrangements to marry one of the enemy. And on the way back, he breaks one of his vows. You could even call it this, strike one. Strike one. One of his vows has been broken. And it's interesting, it says he didn't tell his parents. You get that? Yeah, they would not have liked to heard this. And so he doesn't tell his parents what he's been up to. After that, things get really sideways with this whole thing. Judges 14:10 says, so his father went down to the woman, and Samson gave a feast there, for young men used to do so. This is a wedding feast. So they're going along with this. They're going to let this marriage happen. And I imagine, again, mom and dad aren't used to saying no to Samson, so they're going to let this thing happen. And they're going down to have a wedding feast. Now, a wedding feast in those days, understand the culture here. In those days, a wedding feast wasn't a two-hour thing up in the fellowship hall. Okay? A wedding feast was 7 days. And people were invited, both sides, to come and just party for 7 days. But typically, in Israel culture, the feast was held at the bridegroom's house with his family. Okay, that would have been Samson's parents' house. But this is happening where? In her family's house, in Timnah. Now, this isn't the way it was typically done. And so it gives you just this little insight that maybe mom and dad are going to let it happen, but you and I have no party at their house. Get the drift? I mean, they're willing to let this thing happen, and they'll go down to the wedding, but they're not going to host it. They're not going to have all those Philistines in their house. They're going to have this party down in their place. They still have these, by the way, in Middle East. They're called Sadagwa weddings. They take place in the bride's family instead of in the groom's family house. So they, you know, it wasn't unheard of, but it was rare. Didn't actually happen very much. Now, you might also ask yourself this. Is there another reason why mom and dad wouldn't go there? Well, there is, and it's important to the story. In verse 10, Samson gave a feast there. Now, a feast meant, in that culture, almost beyond shadow of a doubt, that there would have been a lot of wine. I mean, just think about Jesus in the wedding of Canaan. I mean, wedding feasts had wine. Everybody get it? That's what they did. When you had a feast, there was wine. It wasn't like, well, will this be a non-alcoholic feast? Never happened. Right? This would have been a feast, and it would have been wine. Now, was Samson allowed to drink wine? Church? No. Okay. All of a sudden, in the story, you have strike number two. First, he touched that dead animal. Then he's at a wedding feast where there's wine flowing. That's number two. Strike number two. Now, if we look at this verses 15 through 17, another disturbing thing happens. We're almost to the end. Hang with me, guys. It says in verse 15 of chapter 14, it came to pass on the seventh day. Now, that's the seventh day of the wedding feast. Everybody with me? Okay, they've been partying, feasting, dancing, staying up late, getting up early. 7 days, okay? So on the seventh day that they said to Samson's wife, now, they are the Philistines. Remember, this is happening in the country of the Philistines, in a Philistine home, Philistine people. Amen? Follow me? They say to his wife, the Philistine lady, entice your husband that he may explain the riddle to us. Now, we don't have time for the whole riddle, but he had given a riddle and made a bet, a wager with this riddle. And they're mad because they couldn't figure it out. You can read about that. The point is that they went to his wife and said, entice your husband. Lady, where is your loyalty? Is your loyalty to your husband? Or is your loyalty to the Philistines? Entice your husband, that he may explain the riddle to us, or else we'll burn you and your husband's and your father's house with fire. Oh, good friends. Have you invited us in order to take what is ours? Is that not so? Samson's wife wept on him. And he said, you hate me. You don't love me. You posed a riddle to the sons of my people, but you have not explained it to me. And he said to her, look, I've not explained it to my father or my mother, so why would I explain it to you? Now she wept on him the 7 days while their feast lasted. And it happened on the seventh day that he told her, because she pressed him. Then she explained the riddle to her people. So Samson is betrayed. She whines and kicks up a fuss, you know, oh, Samson! Ah! And finally he gives in. And she turns right around and tells the enemy, just like that. And he's betrayed by his brand new wife. Now the pattern here is that a man who cannot say no to his lusts and his passions and to the women. He can't deny it. He knows it's going to cost him a fortune, this bet he made, but he can't just say no. And so he gives in to the wife, and terrible things happen. You can read about those in the ongoing verses. Now, let's go to chapter 15. Chapter 15. And by this point in the story, Samson has violated 2 out of the 3 vows that he has made. Are you all tracking with me? 2 out of the 3 vows that consecrated him to the Lord, he has violated. He's down to just 1 strike left. Chapter 15. He gets so angry about what's going on with the Philistines and his wife and the whole thing that he just has a terrible, terrible battle and kills a bunch of them. And man, it's looking like this guy is almost indestructible. He's like Superman. He can do anything. But then when we come to chapter 16, here's where we're coming out to the end of the story. In chapter 16, another woman enters the story. This is the woman Delilah. You've probably heard of Samson and Delilah. And so looking at chapter 16, verses 4 and 5, let's do this. We're almost there. It says this. Afterward, it happened that he loved a woman in the valley of Sorek, whose name was Delilah. Now, the phrase loved a woman is a kind way of saying he was intimate with her. That's just how they said it in those days. He loved a woman. He was intimate sexually with this woman, Delilah, in the valley of Sorek. And so here's a guy, again, who's loose with the women. And now he's hanging out with Delilah. Verse 5. The lords of the Philistines came to her and said to her, entice him. That sounds like his wife. Entice him, they said to him. And find out where his strength lies and by what means we may overpower him, that we may bind him to afflict him. And every one of us will give you 1,100 pieces of silver. So they come to this woman, Delilah. Now, they've debated over the years whether or not Delilah was a prostitute. Some say she probably was. Others say she may not have been. It doesn't say she was a prostitute. But she is willing to entice him for money. She's willing to do what it takes to get the secret out of him for 1,100 pieces of silver. Now understand, 1,100 pieces of silver, listen guys, it's a fortune. It's retirement. It's more money she'd probably make in a lifetime. And they're offering it to her for one thing. Just get this big dude to tell us the secret of his power so that they can overpower him. 1,100 pieces of silver. What would you do? Where would your loyalty be? Somebody came to you and offered you, I don't know, what would be the equivalent today? $5 million maybe? To entice somebody? So they offer her the money. This Delilah. And again, we don't know if she was in the habit of this or not. It does kind of seem like it, but we don't know that. So he begins to hang out with this Delilah, and she begins to do the same kind of thing his wife had done. Samson, tell me your power. Tell me your secret. And she's tenaciously, you know, just asking him time after time after time after time. And that brings us to the scene in 16:15. We're back now in our Netflix movie to the climax. He's hanging out with Delilah. He's got two strikes on him out of the three. This woman is just pestering him to death to tell him, you know, the strength. And he likes her. He's sleeping with her. And she's saying, you don't love me. And she's, you know, giving him the time. And finally, as was his pattern. Not if you're getting it. It was his pattern. He gives in to this woman. And he tells her about his strength. Verse 20 is one of the saddest scriptures we have. 16:20. Where he told her the secret to his strength. She brings in some kind of a barber of some kind. He cuts off Samson's hair. And then she says, the Philistines are upon you, Samson. And the man leaps to his feet. He's going to beat those guys silly. And then he realizes that God was gone. He didn't have the strength. Strike three. First, touched the animal. Second, drank alcohol. Third, let his hair be cut. Three strikes and you are what? Didn't even realize that his strength had left. He'd grown so accustomed to doing things on his own, pridefully just going along without mindfulness of the Lord, that when his consecration was broken, when he was no longer in fellowship with God by his own choice, he didn't even know it until he jumps to his feet and tries to, you know, wrestle and grapple and finds out that he's as weak as a kitty. Well, they take him, they poke out his eyes, they put him in bronze shackles, and says he became a grinder. Well, a grinder was a person who spent the whole day walking around in circles, either crushing grapes or on a millstone crushing like wheat. So all day long, he would just walk in a circle, mindlessly grinding. Oh, how the mighty have fallen to that place. So here's my question, church, as we're wrapping this up. Was Samson's power in his hair? Now think about it. Was his power in his hair? Was the cutting of his hair some sort of magical thing? You know, you cut the hair and now he's weak. Was his power in his hair? How many say, yes, it was in his hair? How many say, no? Yes, you passed the test. The power wasn't in his hair. The power was in the Holy Spirit working through a consecrated person. The hair was the outward symbol of that. But he'd already had two strikes. He broke his vows. He had committed sin with the enemies. He had become prideful in himself. And finally, he'd been full of, get this, church, here's a word. Get this as we close. He'd become presumptuous. He figured, I'll still be strong even if I cut my hair. I can tell Delilah whatever, I'll still be able to do it. He'd come to presume that God would always be there for him, even when he broke the vows. So we go back to, makes you go, what was the deal with his hair? The thing with his hair was it spoke to his consecration to God. Nothing to do with the hair itself, everything to do with his walk with God. There's actually hope in this story. Verse 22, I want to close with a word of hope here, because it's such a sad and tragic end, isn't it? But verse 22 gives us hope. In fact, the story ends on a bit of a hopeful note. Verse 22 says, the hair on his head began to grow again, after it had been shaven. Duh, of course. No, that's not duh, of course. God is saying something. He's saying that there's fresh grace coming again. Even though he had failed, even though he allowed his hair to be cut, even though he had blown it, God says his hair's coming back, meaning there's a fresh chance. There's a fresh opportunity. It's not too late. See, that's our wonderful God. Even when somebody blows it like Samson did, without excuse, amen? Without excuse, God says his hair's coming back. His strength is coming back. There's going to be another opportunity for him. Verses 24 through 30 depicts the end of the story. Just to paraphrase it, his hair grows back. He's blinded. They bring him into the amphitheater to make fun of him, show him off like a monkey or something. They stick him between two pillars that hold the weight of the place, and they don't understand what's going on here, because as his hair grew back and as he repented, his strength came back. Now, he couldn't undo the consequences, but his strength still came back. And, of course, you know the story. He pushes the pillars aside, and the whole place comes down and kills thousands of Philistines and Samson. Now, I want to give you some takeaways here from the story. Interesting story. Makes you go, There are some good takeaways here, okay? The first one is this. We all got to own our personal walk with God. I mentioned that earlier. See, I'm not exactly sure how much of this stuff Samson bought into early on. Remember, he wasn't there. He wasn't born when all this was set up. You can't have a life of faith based on somebody else's faith. You can't walk with God based on your parents' or your grandparents' faith. Now, he had wonderful godly parents, and they set him up to succeed really well. But all of us are accountable for our own walk with God. Now, there's nothing wrong with having a great legacy of faith. Amen. If you're my grandparents served Jesus, my parents served Jesus, my uncles served Jesus, my nieces served Jesus, that's good. Amen. But it won't get you into heaven. You, just like Samson, have got to buy in to faith in Jesus Christ yourself. Now, you get a leg up when you're raised in a family of faith. You do. It's great to be raised that way. But it won't get you into heaven, just like it didn't make Samson keep his vows. You got to own your own walk with faith. Say amen if you get it. Number two, I'm hurrying. Number two, the decline of one's relationship with God is often gradual and sometimes barely perceptible. Again, this is a tragic story, and this is one of the takeaways for Samson. That walk with God slips away ever so slowly. It starts with one sin, and then there's another sin, and then there's a third sin, and it just slowly, imperceptibly begins to walk away. And one day a person looks around and realizes they got no heart for God. They don't care. It didn't happen all at once. It slowly slips away. It's like a praying, Satan is like a praying mantis. He doesn't always come in and just attack you up front. You'd see that. But he comes in slowly, carefully, lays traps and snares that one step after another slowly leads us away from God. Sometimes we don't even connect the dots. Decisions that we made. But a person, if they're watching a movie, would say, oh yeah, seen this scene, this scene, this scene. I saw how you got there. Just as an example, I want to give you a quick example of this. We knew a family down in Kent who were in our home group, and they were doing great with God. They were close to God. They were in church on Sundays, home group midweek, serving the Lord, on fire for the Lord. And somewhere in that whole thing, they made a decision together that they were going to buy a camping trailer. Now, there's nothing wrong with a camping trailer. Everybody get that? Nod your head. I'm not saying that's wrong. But they bought a camping trailer, and they spent a lot of money on this camping trailer. And I remember in the group, we're praying, oh, God, help them know what to buy, and the whole thing. They bought a camping trailer. But if you're going to have a camping trailer, you got to go camping, right? So they started missing church on Sundays. Why? Well, they're camping to use the camping trailer. And then they found out that their car really couldn't tow this camping trailer, so they had to buy something to tow the camping trailer. Now they got to work overtime to pay for the truck, to pay for the camper, and they're missing church on Sundays so they can go camping. Then we noticed that they weren't coming to our home group anymore. Why weren't they at the home group anymore? Well, you got to prepare the trailer to go camping. And slowly but surely, some of you are nodding because you get this story. It could have been a boat. It could have been a trailer. It could have been. You see what I'm saying, though? And soon, their spiritual life had gone away to nothing. Now, they wouldn't have said it was because of a camping trailer. But you can see little decisions that were made that took them out of fellowship with God, little things that they did that brought them out of the correct environment into a wrong environment. They got plugged into relationships that weren't godly relationships. And before you could even know it, they're far from God. Not in one big jump, but a lot of little steps. Nod your head if you're getting it. Okay, you get it? All right, number three. Another of the takeaways is sin has consequences. I know sin is unpopular to talk about. I know that sin is, not cool to talk about. But sin has consequences. Even to Samson, it has consequences. See, he tried to play with sin. He tried to get close to sin. He tried to commit little bitty sins. Nobody noticed. He was messing around with sin. But sin will always overtake us. I know we don't like to hear that, but it's true. And a good shepherd tells you the truth. Sin will overtake you. It always does. Nobody gets away from that. That is a universal principle. Now, I'm not talking about when you mess up, you foul up, you make it. That's different. This is an intentional choice to do the wrong thing. And listen, it always catches up with everybody. Number four, and the last one, God's grace can bring restoration. God's grace brings restoration. It's a sad story. Samson's story is sad. It's tragic. But at the end of the story, we see God's grace at work. He does begin, indeed, to rescue the people from the Philistines, even in his death. And in the end, his hair grows back, his strength is there. You see grace in his life. Romans chapter 5. 6 through 9, we close. For when we were without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. That's like Samson, without strength. Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely would a righteous man will one die. Yet perhaps for a good man, someone would dare to die. But God demonstrates his love towards us, that while we were sinners, Christ died for us. Much more than having been justified by his blood, we will be saved from wrath through him. See, church, that's the story for all of us, for each and every one of us. We were sinners, we were lost, we were far from God, we were indeed bound by sin and in need of rescuing. Jesus Christ is that rescue. He is that salvation. All of us are, in some sense, like Samson. We've all broken our vows. We've all sinned. We've all messed up. But Jesus is sufficient for all of us. See, that's the good news. The good news isn't that a powerful man was sinful and messed up. The good news is that God forgives us and restores us, just as he did Samson. So, let's close with prayer. Let me ask the question, are you all in? Are you all in for God? Samson, not so much. How about you? Are you all in? Or are you playing with sin? feel like an old Pentecostal preacher saying that. Are you playing with sin? Are you just trying to sneak by, you know, thinking it won't matter? But God is calling us to be all in, 100% consecrated to Him. And when we do that, the power of God flows through us, just as it did Samson. So my challenge is, of course, I can't read your mind. I don't know what you do outside the church. But if you are indeed breaking promises, living in ways that bring shame, living far from God, now is the time to get right. Right now. Not tomorrow. Not because you don't know if you got tomorrow. This is the time. Right now. Let's bow our heads. Heavenly Father, we thank you that even in a tragic story like the one of Samson, we find hope, we find grace. Lord, help us to learn from Samson. Help us to be able to apply the lessons from this ancient story to our life today. Lord, help us to be people who are all in, 100% consecrated to God. Lord, help us to stay far from sin, to walk near to you, so we can see your power working through us to the people around us. Lord, there's so much more we could say. But I'm praying for your Holy Spirit right now to touch hearts. And perhaps you're the one I'm talking to. Perhaps this voice is rattling off your soul because you know you've been living like a Samson. And it's time to repent. It's time to say no. It's time to turn back to God. To experience His grace and His love, His fellowship. So if that's you, I'm just going to invite you to say a little prayer with me. You can just say it quietly. God will hear. You would say something like this. You'd say, God, I'm sorry for my sins. I'm sorry I've been living far from you. Forgive me, God. Help me to live all in. Help me to be far from sin and close to you. I give my life to you. I repent, Lord. Flow through me with your saving grace and your forgiveness as I receive that right now in Jesus' name. Everybody says, amen. Makes you go, hmm.